All right, how's it going? Okay, so I just want to start off by saying that I'm gonna like plow through this topic and just kind of speak in a matter-of-fact way. I have to remind you that I criticize people's ideas all the time, and I expect to be criticized. I expect my ideas to be criticized, and if you're watching this, then I expect you to make comments and try to come up with criticisms of what I'm saying. I don't criticize people, I criticize their ideas, and I expect you to do the same, because I see that as virtuous. Also, for people that whine about how I'm shoving my ideas down their throat, well, you can just how about I say this? If I was an expert on Laotian blacksmithing, then my channel would be about Laotian blacksmithing, and that's what I would talk about. But I don't know anything about that topic, so I'm not going to say anything. And I try to say things that I'm really, really confident saying. And very, very few things I'm very confident in saying. I'm really plowing through this subject. Not being held back by anyone, any belief system or organization. I'm really trying to find answers to questions that I have. I'm not waiting around for anyone. All right, so the topic is, it's a lot of different topics. Everything's related, but the topic is basically, I guess you could say, being able to see the future and what that means. So to start off, I recommend a channel. A couple of channels by this guy named Robert Sepper. I'll probably put something in the description. And he calls himself an anthropologist. So, I think that he has a very shallow, like, New Ager perspective on some of the stuff he talks about, but I'm not gonna hold it against him because that's, he's not making any claims. That's not his job. So I'm not criticizing his thoughts. I'm just, in his recent video, he made a statement that it just makes a good frame for what I'm gonna talk about. I was gonna talk about it anyway, but it's just. It's a good frame for what people's mindsets could be. So basically, in his video about skulls, like secrets about skulls, I don't know. It's the one about skulls. Around 5.5 minutes, he mentions the oracle at Delphi seeing the future. And then he goes on to say that it is due to sacred use of prana, chi, orgone, vril, etc. And basically, those are different words for spirit or mind. And I view it in the monistic sense, where spirit is the same as mind. So basically, when you experience the color red, that would be spirit, or prana, chi, orgone, vril. And he talks about it like circulating in the blood and stuff. Okay. Forget about that. So I wanted to talk about the part about seeing the future. And it's okay, let me just back up. He talks about this oracle. He mentions the Oracle of Delphi seeing the future and says that it is due to sacred use of spirit. The seeing the future part is not due to spirit. What it actually is, and I'm really going to go into detail explaining myself, but what it actually is a result of transcending spirit. It's going even beyond spirit. Spirit actually, in the context of what I'm talking about today, it holds you back. It's spirit is shackles. It's kind of a prison, and prevents you from being able to see the future. So first of all, I'm going to use the terms implicate order and explicate order because those are terms used in David Bohm's holographic universe theory, which I think is very close to the understanding of reality, and it explicitly has an ontological basis in neutral monism. And if that doesn't ring your bell, if that doesn't tickle your fancy like it does mine, then you should go back and watch older videos of mine. Because I'm plowing through this stuff. I'm getting into more advanced stuff now. And I'm trying to make these things accessible to other people. That's what I'm trying to do. So that's why I'm making these videos. It's a progression of knowledge. Okay, so basically when I say that seeing the future is beyond spirit, I'm saying that spirit is a part of the explicate order, while seeing the future is a product of the true reality, the implicate order. Basically, spirit is explicate or mundane, just like physical matter. These are the characteristics of our explicate order, or the reality which we perceive and measure. It's the reality that we can comprehend, but it is ultimately an illusion that we are shackled to. And all of these phrases I'm using are metaphorical because it's not really an illusion in the sense of a hallucination. When I say the word perception, I'm not referring to the actual, physiology, like a limit of the meat senses. This is, I guess I could say, ontological illusion. I don't think there's a better word for it. But also, I don't really. Well, I'm kind of gonna get into that. It's. I can't say that I understand this stuff perfectly well. And partly it's due to limitations of language. Partly. It's not really a prison, even of the mind, And these are just metaphors people have used through the millennia to help each other understand true reality. Basically, the way I see it is that the implicate order is a single hypersphere, a fourth dimensional sphere. And this naturally leads to all of the complexity of our entire 3D universe and all of the forces and laws within it. And you might think that's crazy, Eric. How could a simple geometrical shape lead to all of the complexity of our entire 3D universe and all the forces and laws within it? It's just a simple geometrical shape. And to that I say, I know, right? Sounds crazy. But really, people overestimate their grasp on higher dimensions. I mean, just one level up, just the fourth dimension. I haven't even begun to get into any possible fifth dimension. And I know that in mathematics, you have all these, you know, they've gone up to like 12 dimensions or whatever. And when I say that 4D, like comprehending the fourth dimension is like pretty much beyond me. I imagine a lot of people hearing that and thinking, oh, well, all these mathematicians like know about 12 dimensions. So like he must be pretty dumb if he can only comprehend, you know, can't even comprehend four dimensions. Like, I'm not trying to step out of my lane or anything, but these dimensions are pretty much just, I'm not doing the same task as a mathematician. What I'm doing is providing context to things. Whereas a mathematician, especially these days, is does nothing in context. Like the context of reality. They use mathematical tricks to make hypothetical and fantasy mathematics work. It's not based on real life data, a lot of it. And a lot of it is based off of what ifs, such as what if there were monopoles? Or what if there were unicorns or leprechauns? And the people who have a mind for math, like I said, don't have an interest in they're mostly INTJs, and INTJs don't have that library where they are measuring things relative to each other. Basically, they have, as far as I understand it, because I'm not an INTJ, but they basically have, instead of ideas being laid out and organized relative to each other in a library, like every idea is a book in the library. Instead of that, they have kind of like a list or lists of ideas ranked by which ones are better or more efficient or something like that. And that's good. Society really needs people like that. You know, to do certain things, but there are other ways of thinking. There are other people that do other jobs, like me. Yeah, basically today math is more like a form of psychology, and it's because of this paradigm we're in, this postmodern physicalism, You can go onto Google and search for images of 4D shapes, but all it is you're looking at is a 3D shape on a 2D screen. Sometimes they're illustrated as moving images, and people will say that expresses the movement of time. But you have to think, like, what time? Someone drew this image at time X, and the image will cease to exist at time Y. What about before or after that? This is supposed to be something that is not really an object that you can hold. I mean, you can say that every object is 40 because it exists through time. But for example, you can pick up a banana and eat it, but you can't pick up a banana as it exists in its entirety throughout time. So basically, people use this analogy. It's kind of like a worm. Like, here's a banana at this moment, this moment, and this moment, and then over time, it's like this worm, like this fourth dimensional worm banana thing. But you can't pick up the worm. Basically, what I'm saying is you're imagining it as a 3D object. See what I mean? Like, it's a worm. Like, a worm is a 3D object. Even if it's a bunch of bananas connected together, you're, in that instance, basically you're replacing one of the dimensions from our 3 dimensions and putting in the fourth dimension so that you're able to comprehend it. Okay? And basically, what I'm saying is that you can't really comprehend fourth. No, you can't comprehend the fourth dimension, because what I'm talking about is I, just like very many other people, are trying to figure out how to actually transcend that level of perception. And I've actually been looking for cases of people who have done this, and there are so many instances where people have moments where they have transcended that. Anyway, if you think about it, there's no definite time period when the banana came into existence or ceased being a banana. The banana, in essence, which is another word for, which is my word for spirit or spectral. The banana, in essence, looking at it from fourth dimensions, or the fourth dimension, is a microcosm of the universe. I'm not gonna. Anyway, and beyond essence, it is the universe. So basically, what I'm saying is that the banana is the entire universe. Actually, the every single atom in the banana is the entire universe. And I could explain that in terms of the explicate or the implicate order. Basically, it's the same thing. In our reality that we can perceive, it manifests itself as self-similar and hierarchical. And the reason it's self-similar and hierarchical, well, I'll get into that. So if you're able to perceive the implicate order, you'd be able to see the entire past and future of that desk right there. If you're next to a desk, you'd be able to see that desk's entire past and future. Like, you'd just be able to see it just as easily as you see its length. But right now, the way that you imagine the desk's past and future is as a collection of slices in time. And you play it's kind of like a movie that you play in your mind. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about just seeing it. Like the length. People have done this before, And the reason people have done this before is because they are the banana. I know it sounds very deep. Now here's something interesting to think about. You're able to see a banana in Ecuador in the year 1643 because you are that banana. You're also able to see a banana on Mars in the year 2562 because you are that banana. I don't know. I don't know if there are bananas on Mars in the year 2562, but you get the point. So spirit, prana, vril, etc. are basically ways of saying experience. And if you see the future, you're experiencing it. So the experiencing part itself is mundane, part of the illusion, just like physical matter. However, the aspect of accessing an experience at a different time is the result of a transcendence of mundane reality. And you can theoretically experience what it's like to be a Martian banana, just as the Martian banana may be able to experience what it's like being you, because you and the banana are one and the same. So the question is, what technique does one use to gain this, quote, superpower? The short answer is that it requires no technique at all because you already exist in that form, you're just not aware of it. It's not really a superpower. So the real question is, how do you become aware of it? And that's a good question. I'm glad you asked me, but I have no idea. Humanity has been trying to find a good answer to that for millennia. I am not the first person to talk about this subject. And you might be thinking everything I'm saying is useless BS, and if you are, then thank you. You understand how I feel about this and pretty much everything else in life. This understanding of reality is not necessarily false, simply because it does not bear pragmatic fruit that helps you make money or something. It is very logical and it is close to the end result of human thought. And I think that if you dismiss this, then you are an anti-intellectual. Basically, that means you think it is a virtue to not learn new things or step outside of your comfort zone to take on greater responsibility with greater knowledge. And I wish that I was as dumb as you so that I could go about my meaningless life doing whatever and then die. Fortunately, I'm not a cynical nihilist, and I truly embody the spirit of science, and I have a thirst for knowledge that I hope never diminishes. If it does, then please slap me. I use the term superpower on purpose because this is how people view, this is the word people actually use. They call it superpower. And I use it on purpose. The actual word is called siddhis. Siddhis. Basically, the siddhis are the ability to perceive the implicate order. And there's this guy, Patanjali. His Yoga Sutras are just one of many texts discussing exactly what I'm discussing right now. Essentially, the techniques to perceive the implicate order, aka transcending the explicate order. I also think that this is what the Emerald Tablet is about. I will cite Ken Wheeler's translation here, and I'll also put that in the description. So Hermes Trismegistus or Trismegistus, he starts talking about how everything is, above is below, everyone knows about that, yada yada yada. And a lot of people view that as pointing out how reality is hierarchical and self-similar. And that's I'm glad that people say that because I agree with that. And that's what the explicate order is. is arranged in that fashion. And then in the Emerald Tablet, the next lines down mention how everything is, quote, sprung from the divine and, quote, birthed from the divine or the one. How I read these first few lines together is that nature is self-similar and hierarchical because everything comes from the one thing. Keyword, because. And I'm suggesting because that's how it reads. That's how the Emerald Tablet reads. It talks about above versus below. Everything, you know, is birthed from the divine. So, point one, point two. And so, what that's describing in actual words is kind of like a holographic projection. That's basically what a hologram is. And now we're back at the topic of projection. Specifically, stereographic projection. The Poincaré disk model. And I have reason to believe that places which mention, and I talked about this in a previous video, myths that have to do with light in the context of a demiurge type character or a light bearer, in all of these myths, I think that the light actually is in reference to the mathematical light in projection, which is neither actual illumination nor a kind of a commentary about like knowledge. I think that it is in reference to the mathematical concept of stereographic projection. Therefore, the distinction between things, comma, coherence and decoherence, comma, being the same as death, or, quote, darkness, shall, quote, fly from you once you, quote, know this truth. Those are quotes from the Emerald, or at least Ken Wheeler's translation. So it's a kind of illusion, and it doesn't really exist in the first place. To know this truth and to, quote, transcend, you must be, quote, cunning and or wise. So being cunning and wise to transcend the shackles of the illusion is theoretically possible. And I think that one would clearly know if they had transcended, because they'd be able to see the future, and they'd be able. But, you know, that's the main one. I think that's the obvious one. So there's the topic of remote viewing the past and the future, and the question again is how do they do that? How do they do that? Some of the people doing this are not, they're not scholar types. They're not scholar types. And what I'm trying to say is that the ability to see the future when you're remote viewing doesn't require being a scholar. So that's not the answer. The answer is not be a scholar your whole life. That's not the answer. It seems to happen on accident. And from what I've gathered from remote viewers, it's becoming apparent to me that such perceptions are normal and non-stop in everyone all the time, as there is no concrete difference between someone who is remote viewing and someone who is not. And remote viewers normally do not do altered states of consciousness, and they often view that as hindering your ability to remote view. So it doesn't require being a scholar. It doesn't require doing like all these weird rituals. It doesn't require doing altered states of consciousness. But the question is, how'd I do it? Because it's pretty much like on accident, kind of. It like in a lot of stories about it, it's what happens is that they remote view a target, but they get the time wrong. They see the future or the past accidentally. So it's not like it's not false information. It's just it's like it's so it's like they're getting all the information, but they're just becoming aware of the wrong part, the part that they didn't want. But it's all correct. One last comment on the possible technique. I went into detail in my last video about near-death experiences, explaining how there are many ways that people enter into altered states of consciousness. And usually people latch onto one particular method, and it becomes like some cultural practice where you have to do it to be a moral person or some bullshit like that. And I explain what I think is an effective method for manipulating your senses. So, like in Robert Sepper's video, talks about how they used to drink freaking menstrual blood out of a someone's skull, and they used to have like orgies or so, I don't know. But the reason people have done weird shit like that in the past is to attain altered states of consciousness. I don't think I'm the method I laid out is I think is pretty effective, the most effective, the easiest, the most effective, the safest. And it's pretty metal, but it's not as metal as drinking menstrual blood, okay? Like, I'm edgy, just not that edgy, okay? So, the general idea, I think, is to kind of sort through your various experiences to hone in on those that are not a direct result of your physical reality. Altered states aren't necessary. Remote viewers have avoided them. You're already perceiving things from other times and places, I think. And I think that it's constant. I think that you are right now able, if you wanted to, able to perceive any location at any time period right now if you wanted to. I do believe that that is within your abilities. And I think that the real question is, how to become aware that you're doing that. And so then you get into the concept of the subconscious. And like when someone uses the word subconscious, like I know what they're talking about. Everyone knows what you're talking about when you use the word subconscious. But I think that's what you're imagining when you say the word subconscious doesn't really exist in reality. I think that everything is already conscious. Like I actually don't know what subconscious, what does that even mean? I don't I don't know what that means. And the way people think and talk, it's like they believe that they're disconnected from their own minds and bodies. Like they don't have control over their own minds and bodies. And people use language like, "Oh, my brain is playing tricks on me." And like, yeah, I know what you're talking about, because that's like common vernacular and everyone knows what you're talking about. But it doesn't make sense, because your brain is not playing tricks on you. You are your brain, and you have control over what your brain and your body does. Don't think there is such a thing as a subconscious, and that's also why I don't use the term, the same term as Jung, the collective unconscious. I don't think that exists. So I'm starting to think that knowledge itself isn't something that's like accumulated. Like usually you to gain knowledge, you do certain tasks in the world and you arrive at some conclusion. You gather information. Like your eyes will, light will reflect off of the page into your retina, and then your brain will process that, and then you'll go through this process of understanding, and that's voila, knowledge. And I'm suspicious that that is kind of like a long way around. What I'm saying is that I'm suspicious that this concept of knowledge is something that is attained and accumulated. And I think that maybe what's going on is that when you learn something new consciously, like you become aware of it, and it's basically what's happening is that you're becoming aware of something you already knew. So I'm finally back at the great mystery. How does a prophet know what's true and what's false? Or how does a prophet separate falsehoods from truth? Is it a linguistic thing? Like if we say the right words to ourselves and we become immediately aware of that which we had been ignoring? Like is that what subconscious is? You're being ignorant of something that's right in front of your face. Or is it that all prophecies are true, and we just can't nail down the precise time period? It's like someone who is remote viewing, they just get the time wrong. Does our perception simply represent a symbol of the general cyclical patterns in time? And that's getting a little bit into astrology. Also, this is entering the realm of stuff like vision magic and archetypes. In a way, John Dee viewed the angels in this way, as if what he was really doing was accessing a deeper part of his consciousness to retrieve knowledge he already had. And that's it for my notes. I think maybe I forgot some of my notes, but anyway, I think I've talked for long enough. Yeah, that's Shalom.